Assalamualaikum and good morning everyone. Today we will learn on chapter 6, plasma membrane and transport of molecules. So in this topic you will learn about two types of plasma membrane model, sandwich and fluid mosaic model, the transport proteins, the types of transport protein, and also the transport of small and large molecules. And at the end of the chapter and at the end of the lecture letter, you will understand the structure and the functions of the plasma membrane, the characteristics of the membrane protein, and also the mechanism of transportation across the membrane. So let's look into the general properties of plasma membrane. Plasma membrane is made up of a continuous bilayer of phospholipid molecules with the proteins molecules that embedded on it, and it's actually a boundary that helps to separate the living cells from its non-living surrounding. And the layer of the plasma membrane is thin with 8 nanometer thickness that will help to control the traffic into and out of the cells, and it is selectively permeable, meaning to say that it will only allow some substances across more easily than others. And the main macromolecules in membrane are lipids, protein, and also carbohydrates. And the most abundant are the phospholipid that make up the phospholipid bilayer. And the phospholipid itself is actually an amphiphatic molecules, meaning to say they have both hydrophobic and hydrophilic region. So as we all know, phospholipids, they have two sides. We have the hydrophilic side because they do have what we call as the phosphate group in the head, and also two fatty acid tails as here that give the hydrophobic sides of the phospholipids. And models of membranes were actually developed long before the membranes were first seen with electron microscope in 1950s, and attempts to build artificial membrane provided insight into the structure of real membrane. And in 1917, Irving discovered that the phospholipid dissolved in benzene would form a film on water when the benzene evaporated. So this is how the hydrophilic heads were looks like when they are immersed in the water. They will form what we call as a film here after the benzene evaporated. And Gotter and Grendel reasoned that the cell membrane must be a phospholipid bilayer. So the molecules in the bilayer are arranged such that the hydrophobic fatty tails are sheltered away from the water. Meanwhile, the parts of the hydrophilics will interact with the water. And the first models of the plasma membranes is actually proposed by Davison and Danielli, which is sandwich model, in which that the phospholipid bilayer lies between two layers of globular protein. And one suggestion was that the proteins on the surface increase adhesion. And then early images on electron microscope seem to support Davison Danielli. However, there are two problems with this sandwich model, or known as Davison Danielli model. The first one is that not all membranes will look like, because they are different in their thickness, appearance when they are being stained, and also the percentage of the lipids. And also, they shown that the membrane protein are actually not very soluble in water, because membrane protein are amphiphatic with hydrophobic and also hydrophilic region. And if at the surface, hydrophilic regions would be in contact with the water. And the second model that we are using now is fluid mosaic model that is being proposed by Singer and also Nicholson. They said that the membrane protein are dispersed and individually inserted into the phospholipid bilayer, just like this. And in this model, the hydrophilic regions of the protein is in contact with the water, meanwhile the hydrophobic regions are in non-aqueous environment. And one of the methods that used to separate between the two layers of the phospholipids is known as a freeze structure. It is actually a specialized preparation technique that will split the membrane along the middle of the phospholipid bilayer, prior to electron microscopy. And this shows that the protein particle interspersed with a smooth matrix supporting the fluid mosaic model. And this is the structure of plasma membrane with the membrane protein dispersed throughout the plasma membrane. And other parts, I will explain it after this. So let's look into the fluidity of the membrane. Membrane molecules are in fluid state and held in place by actually a relatively weak hydrophobic interactions, meaning to say there must be liquid and fluid in order to function. So most of the lipids of some protein, they can move either laterally by lateral movement or flip-flop movement. Okay, so here they can move either bilateral movement, side to side, or flip-flop movement. Okay, upside to downside and downside to upside. So the lateral movement, this one, is actually a very rapid, about 2 micron per second. Meanwhile, the flip-flop movement is quite rare, happen in the plasma membrane. And many larger membrane protein also move more slowly but do drift, and some proteins move in very directed manner, perhaps guided by the motor protein attached to the cytoskeleton, and other protein never move and curve by the cytoskeleton, as you see in the figure here. So membrane fluidity is influenced by temperature, saturated and unsaturated fatty acids, and also the cholesterol. Now let's look into the first factor that influences the membrane fluidity, which is temperature. So as temperature cools, the membrane will switch from its fluid state to solid state as the phospholipids are more closely packed with each other. However, if the temperature is hotter, the membrane will switch again from a solid state to fluid state, as the phospholipids will be further apart from each other. And the next factor that will influence the membrane fluidity is saturated, the number of the saturated and unsaturated fatty acid inside the plasma membrane, in which the membrane that is rich with unsaturated fatty acid are more fluid compared to membrane that rich with saturated fatty acids, because unsaturated fatty acids, they have a kink, meaning to say they have double bonds that are located in their hydrophobic tails, okay, that will help to prevent the tight packing of the membrane. Then let's look here, the cholesterol. So the last factor that influences the membrane fluidity is the cholesterol. The cholesterol, is you can see here, is wedged between the phospholipid molecule in the plasma membrane, in which at warm temperature, it will help to restrain the movement of the phospholipid and it will reduce the fluidity of the membrane. Meanwhile, at the cool temperature, it will maintain the fluidity by preventing the tight packing of the phospholipids. So to work properly with active enzyme and appropriate permeability, is actually the membrane must be fluid. Fluid such that look like a salad oil, in which the cell can alter the lipid compositions of the membrane to compensate for changes in fluidity causes by changing temperature. For an example, cold adaptive organisms such as winter wheat increase the percentage of unsaturated phospholipid in during the autumn, and this will allow this organism to prevent the membrane from solidifying during the winter season. And as you can see here, membranes, plasma membranes, are actually a mosaic of structures and also function. It have different proteins that embedded in the fluid matrix of the phospholipid bilayer. So this is the structure of the fluid mosaic model. As you can see here, we have two types of proteins, integral proteins and peripheral proteins. And we have the cholesterol that wedge between the phospholipid bilayer, and then the carbohydrates that attach to the protein that known as a glycoprotein, and also the carbohydrate that attach to the lipids that known as the glycolipids. So phospholipid forms the main fabric, but proteins determine most of the membrane specific functions. So the plasma membrane and the membranes of various organelles each have unique collections of proteins, okay? Different plasma membrane, different collections of a membrane protein. And there are two major populations of membrane protein. The first one is peripheral proteins. Peripheral proteins are the proteins that are not embedded in the lipid bilayer. Instead, they are loosely bounded at the surface of the proteins and often connected to the other populations of the membrane protein, such as this one, okay, and also this one, right? Okay, or it's gonna look like this one. Okay, they attach to another membrane protein. And another one is that integral proteins that will penetrate the hydrophobic core of the lipid bilayer, often completely spanning, as you can see here, the membrane. Where they contact the core, they have a hydrophobic region with non-polar amino acid and often coil into the alpha helix structure. And where they are in contact with the aqueous environment, as you can see here, they have hydrophobic regions or hydrophilic regions of amino acid. So a protein that penetrate the hydrophobic core is the integral proteins, hydrophobic core of the lipid bilayer. So they initially partially penetrate or transmembrane, and then meanwhile, the peripheral protein normally not embedded in the lipid bilayer, but bound loosely to the polar surface of the phospholipid and expose its part of the integral protein. And also, as you can see here on the cytoplasmic side, okay, here, the submembrane protein are held in place by the attachments of the filaments of the by attachment to the cytoskeleton. Meanwhile, at the exterior side, they attach to fibers of the extracellular matrix. And the carbohydrates, as you can see here, are covalently bonded to protein that known as a glycoprotein. That main function is for cell recognition. And also the carbohydrates also, this is the same, okay? And also, as you can see here, the cholesterol helps to stabilize the phospholipid by resisting changes in membrane fluidity that caused by the temperature change. So one role of the membrane protein is to reinforce the shape of the cells and provide a strong framework. So on the cytoplasmic side, some of the membrane proteins connect to the cytoskeleton. Meanwhile, at the exterior sides of the cells, some membrane proteins attach to the fiber of the extracellular matrix. And other than for the transport, plasma membrane, the function is for transport. Its other function is that for the enzymatic activity, for the signal transduction, intercellular joining, cell set recognition, and also the attachment to the cytoskeleton, and also extracellular matrix that are located at the exterior sides of the cells. So, and also membrane is actually have distinctive inside and outside faces, and two layers may differ in their lipid compositions and the protein in membrane that have clear directions. So the outer surface also has the carbohydrate, and this asymmetrical orientations begin during synthesis of new membrane, as you can see here in the endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, so these are the important components of plasma membrane. We have phospholipid, which is the main fabric of the membrane, the cholesterol that attach to the phospholipid, and wedges between the two phospholipid, integral proteins, okay, that the one that embedded with the phospholipid bilayer. We have peripheral on the inner and outer surface of phospholipid barrier, and also the carbohydrates that normally either it attach to the hydrophobic area, or it will attach to the protein, membrane protein. And a membrane molecular organization result in selective permeability. A steady traffic of small molecules and ion move across the plasma membrane in both directions. For example, sugar, amino acid, and other nutrients will enter the cell. However, they will leave our cell as the metabolic waste products. And also our cell absorb the oxygen and also expel carbon dioxide from the cell, and it also helps the regulations of concentration of inorganic ion by shuttling them across the plasma membrane. Okay, so however, substances do not move across the barrier indiscriminately, meaning to say membranes are selectively permeable. And actually, the permeability of the plasma membrane is depend on the interactions of that molecule with the hydrophobic core of the membrane. So the hydrophobic molecules can across the plasma membrane or the lipid barrier easily. Okay, meanwhile, ion and polar molecule pass through the lipid bilayer with difficulty, including water and also small ion. So we have what we call as a transport protein that will help to assist, that will help and regulate the transports of other hydrophilic molecules such as the polar molecules and also ions. Now let's look into the transport protein that we mentioned earlier. So specific ions, polar molecules such as water can cross the lipid bilayer through the transport protein. Transport protein is actually have a much common characteristic with enzyme in which both of them have specific binding site for the solute. They can become saturated when they are translocating passenger as fast as they can. It also can be inhibited by molecules that resemble the normal substrate. And while transport protein do not usually catalyze chemical reaction as like enzyme, but they do catalyze a physical process by transporting a molecule across a membrane that would otherwise be relatively impermeable to the substrate. So there are two types of transport protein. The first one is a channel protein and the second one is a carrier protein, as you can see here. So channel protein is also known as the pore protein, okay, that allow the fast transport through the plasma membrane, in which they provide corridor allowing specific molecules and ion to cross the membrane, and they have a hydrophilic channel, meaning to say small ion and hydrophilic polar molecules can pass through these pore proteins easily. And for example, is water channel proteins. So water channel protein, which is also known as aquaporin, in which it facilitates the massive amounts of diffusions of water that occur in plants and also the animal cells. Okay, they will allow the water to cross the membrane very quickly. And another one of transport protein is carrier protein, which is also known as a gated channel. They can open and close, but it depends on the presence and also the physical presence and also the absence of physical and also chemical stimulus. They can change its shape to move the target from one side to another side. So the chemical stimulus is normally different from the transported molecule. Let's look into the example. When the neurotransmitter binds into specific gated channel on the receiving neutron, this channel will open and allow sodium ion into the nerve cell. And when the neurotransmitter is not present, the channel are closed, and both transport proteins are specific to the substance that it will translocate and move. Example, glucose transport protein only can carry glucose in blood. Okay, however, if fructose try to pass through the glucose transport protein, it cannot, because it must be selective. So later, after this lecture, you have to answer our first questions. Is that step two types of transport protein through the class point. Next, let's look into the transport of small molecules. Transport of small molecules is divided into two types. We have passive transport and also active transport. So passive transport is referred to the movement of particle across the cell membrane down its concentration gradient without using energy. So there are two types of passive transport. The first one, we have osmosis, and the second one is diffusion. Osmosis is actually refer to the diffusions of water molecules through a semi-permeable membrane. Meanwhile, diffusion is referred to the movement of small molecules from an area of high concentration gradient to low concentration. So from high concentrations of the molecule to low concentrations of the molecule. Now let's look into the first type of passive transport, which is referred to osmosis. Specifically, osmosis is referred to the movement of water molecules from high concentration region to low concentration region through the selectively permeable plasma membrane. And there are two important factors that you have to understand that related to osmosis. The first one is osmotic pressure, in which the diffusions of water molecules from regions of lower osmotic pressure to region of higher osmotic pressure through selectively permeable membrane. Meanwhile, the water potential is referred to diffusions of molecules from region of higher water potential region to low water potential region through selectively permeable membrane. So what is actually mean by osmotic pressure and also water potential? So osmotic pressure is actually referred to the measure of the pressure that must be applied to stop the osmotic movement of water across the membrane, in which the water will move from the solution with lower osmotic pressure to the solution with higher osmotic pressure. Okay, they will diffuse across the semi-permeable membrane from low concentrations of solute to high concentrations of solute. Meanwhile, the water potentials is actually referred to the pressure that exerted by freely moving water molecules in system measured in kilopascal that denoted by PSI. So the water molecules is actually can move constant and rapidly and also randomly from one location to another location because of the kinetic energy. So the greater the water molecules in the system, the greater will be the total kinetic energy of water molecules and its water potential. And also, in osmosis, there are three different types of solutions because due to its concentration, different concentration of the solutes that will help, that will lead to the movement of the water. The first one is hypertonic solutions. Hypertonic solution is referred to solution that contain a higher number, the higher number of solutes compared to its solvent. Meanwhile, hypotonic is referred to the solution with higher solvent compared to its solutes, and isotonic is the solution where the solutes and also the solvent are in an equal amount or in equilibrium. So actually our tap water is hypertonic compared to distilled water, but hypotonic when it's compared to the seawater. Okay, so let's look into the example. So as you can see here, imagine two sugar solution differing in concentrations. Okay, here with low concentration of sugar and another one with high concentration of sugar, in which it is separated by selectively permeable membrane, in which this membrane only will allow the water through but not the the sugar. As you can see here, the hypotonic solution has a lower water concentration, a hypertonic compared to hypotonic solution. Therefore, the water will diffuse from high concentration region to low concentration region across the semi-permeable membrane. And the osmosis will continue until the solution reach the equilibrium, which is now known as the isotonic solution. So when two solutions become isotonic solution, the water molecules is actually still moving, but they move at equal rates from one to another, and no net osmosis. Okay, this is similar as what I mentioned earlier. So the cells, okay, or living organism survival actually depends on balancing the water intake, a water uptake, and also water loss from the body. So normally an animal cell immersed in isotonic environment, they will experience no net movement of osmosis across the plasma membrane because the water is moved at the same rate at both directions across the membrane and the volume of water inside the cell is stable. However, when the cell is immersed into a hypertonic solution, in which hypertonic solution contain a higher number of solute in its surrounding solution, the cell itself has a higher concentration of solute compared to its surrounding solution. So what will happen is that the water will diffuse out of the cell and the cell will lose water, they become shriveled, and by time they will probably die because of the crenations. However, when the cell immerses in hypotonic solution, meaning to say the solute in the surrounding solution is low. Okay, the lower osmotic pressure than inside the cell, so the vice versa with hypertonic, the water is diffused into the cell, therefore the cell will gain water, get swell, and sometimes burst in the process of lysis. So for a cell living in an isotonic environment, such as the marine invertebrate, is not a problem. Okay? However, organisms without rigid walls have the osmotic problems, okay, either in hypertonic or hypotonic environment. And they must have adaptations for osmoregulation to maintain the internal environment. For an example, paramecium. Okay? Paramecium is a protease in which is hypertonic when it's compared to its surrounding, the place where it lives. And in spite of the cell membrane that is less permeable to water than other cells, water can still enter the body of the paramecium. And the paramecium have a special vacuole that known as a contractile vacuole that will help to pump the water out from the cell when there's amount of the water intake inside the cell is too much. And the cell of plants, prokaryotes, fungi, and some protists, meanwhile, they have what we call as a cell wall that will help to contribute to the cell's water balance. So the plant cell, in a hypotonic solution, they will swell and the elastic wall oppose further uptake. And at this point, the cell is actually normal, okay, in normal condition, which is known as a turgid, okay? So if the plant cell and its surrounding are isotonic, there is no movement of the water into the cell and the cell become flaccid and may be wilt. Okay, meanwhile, in hypertonic solution, the cell wall has no advantage because the plant cell lose water and its volume become shrink, and by time, the plasma membrane will pull away from the wall and cause the plasmolysis. So as you can see here, okay, hypotonic cause the plant cell become turgid but burst, okay, for animal cell. Isotonic, it helps the animal cell become in normal conditions. However, it caused the plant cell to be flaccid or wilt. Meanwhile, the hypotonic solution, it will cause the animal cells burst or due to the crenations, and it will cause the plant cell become plasmolysis, okay, due to the plasma membrane are pulling away from the cell wall. And the next type of passive transport is diffusion. Passive transport, diffusion is actually difference with osmosis in terms of what are the types of molecules that are being transported. In diffusion, they transport small substances, okay, in which the substances will diffuse from high concentration to less concentration area down its concentration gradient through the selectively permeable membrane. And the diffusion is actually driven by the intrinsic kinetic energy of the molecules, and no energy is required for this type of transportation. As you can see here, the one that move is actually the molecules of the solutes, not the water. Okay? So, each substance diffuses down its concentration gradient independent of the concentration gradient of other substances. As you can see here, the left parts of these solutions, okay, have higher concentration of solute compared to the right part. So the molecules will move from high concentration gradient to low concentration gradient until they reach equilibrium. Okay, so in the nutshell, diffusions, we also can divide it into two types, simple and facilitated diffusion. The only differences between these two is that simple diffusion does not involve or does not need any assistance from the transport protein. Meanwhile, facilitated diffusion, it needs help from the transport protein to transfer the charged molecules and also the polar molecules. Okay? Let's look into this one. This is example of simple diffusion. They can pass through the phospholipid bilayer easily without the help of transport membrane. Meanwhile, the facilitated diffusion, they need help from the transport proteins to cross the plasma membrane, but with no energy, okay, used. So now let's look into the second type of active transport, the second types of transport of small molecules, which is referred to active transport. Active transport is actually referred to the movement of particle against its concentration gradient, meaning to say from low concentration to high concentration gradient, and it needs energy for them to move the molecules. So this requires cells to expend its own metabolic energy, and it normally performed by highly specific or selective protein embedded in the membrane. It the cell that which are active carrying out transport protein will have large number of mitochondria, and the energy which is in the form of ATP is being supplied for most of active transport, and it will be powered out by shifting the phosphate group from ATP forming the ADP to transport the protein, and it will cause the transport protein to have to experience conformational change in its structure that translocate the solutes across the membrane. And active transport is critical for a cell to maintain its internal concentration of small molecules that would be otherwise diffused across the membrane, such as the liver cells. So examples of active transport is sodium potassium pump. This actually helps to maintain the gradient of sodium and potassium ions across of plasma membrane. And normally animal cells has higher concentration of potassium and lower concentrations of a low concentration of sodium inside the cell, and it used the energy, okay, from the ATP to pump 3 sodium ions out from the cell and 2 potassium ions into the cells. Okay, as you can see here, you can read by yourself later how does the carrier proteins, okay, the gated channel, the sodium potassium pump help to transport the sodium and also potassium. So the sequence of sodium potassium pumping event, the process starts from the binding of 3 sodium ions into the membrane protein, as you can see here. Okay, the bonding stimulates the breakdown of the ATP, which in turn result in phosphorylation of the carrier protein, as you can see in this figure. Okay, the phosphorylation will cause the conformational change of the carrier protein. It does change its shape after that, okay, which is allow the sodium leave the cell, and the affinity of sodium is being reduced. Now the sodium ion is being released to the outside of the cells, and the potassium sodium ion will bind to the sodium potassium pump, and it will cause the dephosphorylation of the carrier protein, and the affinity of the potassium reduced, and this the dephosphorylation of carrier proteins trigger change back to the original conformation. Thus the potassium move into the cell, and the circle will keep on repeating again and again. Okay, so in the nutshell, the transport of small molecules involving passive transport and active transport. Passive transport is the movement of molecule from high concentration gradient to low concentration gradient without the use of energy across the selectively plasma membrane. We have two types, diffusion and facilitated diffusion. Meanwhile, active transport is referred to the movement of particles or molecules that against its concentration gradient using and also they're using energy to transport the molecule across the plasma membrane. So after this lecture, you should answer the question is that step 2 main types of transport small molecules, in which I will give the class point caught after this. Last but not least, we have the transport of large molecules. So small molecules and water molecules can leave or enter the cells through the phospholipid barrier or transport protein. However, large molecules cannot transport using the transport protein and also just pass through the lipid bilayer. They need the use or the usage of vesicle and also the vacuole. Okay, so there are two ways to transport large molecule. The first one is endocytosis and the second one is exocytosis, in which both of these transport provide bulk transport of the substances into and out of the cells. So endocytosis can be divided into three types. We have phagocytosis, which is also known as cellulating, phenocytosis, cellular drinking, and also receptor-mediated endocytosis. Okay, now let's look into endocytosis process. So endocytosis, there's the cell takes in macromolecule and particulate matter by forming new vesicles that will be pinched off from the plasma membrane. Okay, the endocytosis is the reversal of the exocytosis, in which the small area of the plasma membrane sinks inward to form a pocket, and then as the pocket here, as you can see, sink inward to forming a pocket, and as the pocket into the plasma membrane deepens, okay, it become deeper here. It will pinch in, forming a vesicle containing the material that have been outside the cell. Now the outside material have been taken into the cell that are being collected inside the transport vesicle. So one type of endocytosis is phagocytosis, which is also known as cellulating, in which solid substance or even whole organism are taken into the cell by invagination of the cell membrane, and it will form a vacuole. And also in the phagocytosis, the cell will engulf the particles, okay, by extending just like this, extending its pseudopodia around it and package it into food vacuole. And the contents of food vacuole are digested, okay, when the vacuole fuses with the lysosome. So that we have two examples, such as the white blood cells, our white blood cells that ingest the bacteria, and also amoeba that engulfing the food particles. Okay. So in pinocytosis, which is also known as cellular drinking, where the cell will engulf droplets of extracellular fluid, the fluid from the outside of the cell, and similar with phagocytosis, they will create a vesicle. The vesicle will become defilled and pinch off into the cells, and there this is a non-specific process. Okay, and then last but not least, we have receptor-mediated endocytosis. Receptor-mediated endocytosis is a special types of pinocytosis, in which it will help to enable the cell to import bulk quantities of specific substances which not be concentrated in the extracellular matrix. Okay, the protein receptor site are embedded in the plasma membrane, as you can see here, and very concentrated in the plasma membrane, exposed to the ECM, extracellular fluid, or exterior sites of the cell. So when the specific molecules bind into the receptor protein cluster, okay, as you can see here, in coated pit, then it will stimulate the molecules to be engulfed into a coated vesicle. So this coated vesicle specific location decoated with clathrin, and also receptor, and so after they ingested the material, it will release from the vesicle. The emptied receptor are recycled to the plasma membrane by the same vesicle. Example is the human cell that take in the cholesterol for membrane synthesis. Okay, so you can look at this chart of the receptor mediated endocytosis and exocytosis later. Now, okay, this is phagocytosis, pinocytosis, non-specific process, and also receptor-mediated endocytosis, that is very specific process. Okay, now let's look into the second types of transport large molecules, which is exocytosis. It is actually a reverse of endocytosis, in which during exocytosis, a transport vesicle budded from the Golgi apparatus is moved by the cytoskeleton to the plasma membrane. Meaning to say, the material packaged in vesicle is being released, okay, released out from the cell or secreted out from the cell when the vesicle membrane fuses with the plasma membrane later. So when the two membranes come in contact, the bilayer will fuse and split the content. So what is it important is actually for secretions of many substances such as the digestive enzyme and also neurotransmitter. So as you can see here, the transport protein that contain the substance, it will fuse with the plasma membrane and later it will secrete out the molecules to the exterior sides of the cells. So this is the picture of how the differences or how different the endocytosis and also exocytosis. You can read by yourself later. And for this one, for the mind map, please answer the summary of the mind map later. After this, after we finish with our lecture. Okay, this is the references.